The bad news is I'll be doing this in English, and even worse news is I have an Australian accent, which which my French boss described as the most difficult accent he'd ever heard in English. So bear with me. I've got quite a lot of material here I'm keen to cover. I will leave these slides with you, so a lot of the information on them will be available. I want to try and do four things here. Firstly, to try and give you some key findings for the whole global energy picture, because of course gas fits into that total energy picture. And that'll be drawn from last year's World Energy Outlook 2013. We're busy printing a new one. In fact, my colleagues are busy back in Paris putting the finishing touches to the 2014 WEO. I just might slip in a few comments about what's new in this year's World Energy Outlook. The second point is how the gas world fits into that and how the gas world is changing very rapidly and in ways that we did not anticipate even a few years ago. Then thirdly, to talk about unconventional gas, which is not just about shale, it's about coal bed methane and tight gas. And finally, a few comments on golden rules, the need to regulate this industry and how important that is. So firstly, to talk about the world energy scene and how things are changing. A lot of the things we took for granted even a few years ago are changing very rapidly. Countries that were very large importers are becoming exporters, or very much on the way to that happening. The United States is the best example, but plenty of other countries as well. 2005, the US was importing nearly 13 million barrels of oil, 13. And that in the space of less than a decade, that number has halved. Secondly, exporters in the Middle East is a good example of this. Most countries in the Middle East actually import gas. An astonishing story. Lots of reasons for it. Resources are not a problem, but policies are. So with the exception of Qatar, most of the other countries import gas. And finally, of course, new supply options for both oil and gas are reshaping everything, the way we think about the world. However, I guess lots of problems remain. And firstly amongst those is CO2 emissions continue to rise. Astonishingly, in Europe, interestingly enough, one of the countries that's seen the biggest improvement in CO2 emissions is the United States, and some of the countries that have the most active policies, such as Germany, have seen the biggest deterioration. We've seen coal use rise in Germany. And again, it comes back to gas markets. Secondly, fossil fuel subsidies, more than $500 billion. Now, most of those are outside OECD countries, but given where the energy growth is, they have very important implications for all of us in this room. And of course, just a minor technical detail, we still have more than 1 billion people without electricity, and at some point those people will want electricity, they'll want energy, they want clean, modern energy, and supplying that will be a real challenge. This year's World Energy Outlook looks at Africa, and you know, if you think Africa's not that important, well, of course, Ebola, everyone in this country is talking about Ebola, and in France as well. Just to pick one country, Nigeria. Nigeria will have 300 million people in about 25 years' time. 300 million people, nearly the population of the US. And of course, if you're a policymaker, you hear nothing but complaints about increase in prices, and that means electricity, and it means gas, and of course it means oil. We've seen oil stay stubbornly close to 100 or above 100, or near $100 for nearly 4 years now. We've never seen that before, and of course we are in a very severe recession. Anyone in Europe knows that. The French have this wonderful phrase, morosité générale économique. I think that translates pretty well into Spanish. They're not very happy about the state of the economy. And my final point, and I'll come back to this so I get time, we have very large differences between regions, and that has important benefits for competitivity in prices. So to talk about energy demand and where is energy demand growth going to happen, and we look at those circles, and there's the OECD, over the next 25 years or thereabouts, hardly any growth in OECD countries. However, what we do see is firstly China, India and Southeast Asia contributing 2/3 of energy demand growth. Now, if you think that seems a little dramatic, bear in mind that China for the last 10 years, every year, has added the equivalent of Spain to its electricity use, every single year for 10 years. And indeed, okay, things are slowing down a bit. Growth in China is only 7%. They only increased electricity demand last year by 290 terawatts hour only, which is roughly Spain, I guess. Remaining growth will come from the Middle East, Africa, Eurasia. But the story here is about Asia. It's not just China, but certainly Asia. And where will demand growth come from? Well, interestingly enough, we did this some 25 years ago, 82% of energy came from fossil fuels. And when we did the numbers for last year, we found that 82% of energy came from fossil fuels. So in 25 years, we've made no change to that. We do project in the next 25 years or so, there will be some changes. Gas in particular, this top bar up here, gas will grow and renewables will grow rapidly, but we will still have 75% of energy from fossil fuels. And that's really quite important. Coal slows, that's a heroic assumption, but that's our key projection. Next year we have a big conference in Paris, which has very high expectations to achieve something on CO2 emissions. The reality is most CO2 emissions now come from outside OECD countries. And you can see here that's a cumulative figure. Up until about 2012 was roughly 50-50 OECD, non-OECD. But looking to the future, you can see that non-OECD emissions for the next 25 years greatly outweigh OECD emissions. And of course China and India will be a very important part of that. China overtook the United States as the biggest emitter, oh goodness, about 5 years ago now, I guess, and has continued to increase energy demand. I might add, of course, that in China, per capita energy use is still very much below OECD levels, a long way below, but rising. If we look at this in terms of the budget, how much we can afford to emit consistent with our so-called 450 or 2 degrees scenario, that is the amount of CO2 that we can emit to stay within an acceptable amount of climate change, we see we've emitted roughly this much historically, and over the next 25 years we'll emit that much. This means we have very, very little room to play with. The 450 scenario is becoming increasingly difficult, I wouldn't say impossible, but very, very difficult and becoming more expensive by the day. Hence the importance of 2015, next year's meeting in Paris. It's a very small amount remaining. I just wanted to talk a little bit about the United States. And this is US oil imports. And I mentioned back in 2005, the US was importing 13 million barrels a day of oil. Already by 2011, that had fallen to just 9 million barrels a day. And that will continue to fall down to roughly 3 million barrels a day. And I'd have to say our projections for this year probably have this falling even further. And you can see a lot of that is new supply, but a lot of it's also energy demand side efficiency. And you can see, in fact, demand side efficiency is actually more important. Anyone who's been to the US knows they drive big cars. They love big cars. They're not getting much smaller, but they are getting more efficient. This is very important because instead of, as I say, the US will be importing less than 3 million barrels a day and will be a big exporter of both gas and coal in that period. So almost net energy self-sufficient. Still a little bit of... So that's the general overview of where we are. Let's have a little look at where gas markets are going. And just a bit of history first, just to see where gas demand production has grown. And you can see the US is obviously a very big part of this story in terms of production growth. Interestingly enough, in 2005, anyone who went to a gas conference in 2005 or 2006, just the World Gas Congress was in Amsterdam, would know that at that time, a lot of people were investing a lot of money to supply gas to the United States, to import gas via LNG. And guess what? Something interesting happened. You can see here production grew dramatically. And that was quite unexpected. It grown by nearly 180 BCM, roughly, 5 to 6 times Spanish gas use in this period. Qatar, very important export-led development. Qatar was, of course, going to be the main supplier to this country. And guess what? The US isn't taking any of that gas anymore. So that gas has found a home. Some of it was in Japan, some of it was other places. rest of the Middle East, a big contributor. China as well. I'll come back to China because China's a really interesting story. Just quickly to talk about demand, and you can see here what I was talking about the Middle East. The Middle East may have been a big gas, big growth in production, but even bigger growth in demand. So the Middle East is actually, apart from Qatar, is actually importing gas. Who would have thought that? None of us thought that. China, look at the demand growth here. 100 BCM, again, roughly three times Spanish gas use, and that's in the last over a 7-year period to 2012, and that has continued. I'll come back to that. The EU, I think we all know very well, the EU has gone backwards. We may see 2007 gas demand levels reached, but it's going to take a long time. Price differentials, again, back until, say, 2010, the major regional gas markets, if you could figure out the correlation between these different prices, and this is the US down here, and this is Japan up here, and these are some European prices, correlation here was tough to manage. But here, this has become extremely durable. We now have very cheap gas here in the US. This is $4 per million BTU. It's $25 oil. It's the equivalent of $25 oil. In Asia, or Japan, $16, that's $100 oil. And in between, you've got Europe, all kinds of interesting things happening in Europe, but a very durable price differential between the US and Europe. Very, very durable. And we're confident that will remain, perhaps not quite as much. But I'll come back to these prices because they have very important implications for demand, for energy-intensive industry, for politics. So, looking ahead, that's 2011 demand and where we see it growing. And I guess what's important here is the US will continue to grow, but not very much. And a lot of that will be exported to China. Now, China, well, 500 billion cubic metres, getting on towards 20 times Spanish gas demand. Now, I'll come back to China in a minute because it is an interesting story. EU, of course, as I mentioned, going backwards. We don't see, well, we see a little bit of growth, but the growth comes very late in the forecast period. For the next 10 years or so, it doesn't look very promising. Okay, China. back in 2002, China was about the same size as Spain. In fact, I think Spain might have been a little bit bigger. By 2005, it had grown to 50 billion cubic metres, about the size of France. Currently, it's running at about 160 billion cubic metres, 160, roughly five times Spain. I might add that at 150 BCM, that's 4% of Chinese energy demand, 4%. There's plenty of scope for growth, and in fact, we have it by 2020 hitting 300 billion cubic metres or thereabouts up here. That's the demand picture. We're pretty confident about that. A lot of that gas will be imported. Some of it will come from Central Asia. Some will come from Russia with a new pipeline right at the end of the forecast period. But a lot of it will come as LNG, and that LNG, originally destined to go to Europe and the United States, will go to China. Okay, production-wise, again, I'll talk a little bit about China because it is interesting. We can see here a big increase in Chinese production, up to 2020, that's mostly conventional. After 2020, it's non-conventional. It's shale gas and coal bed methane. If that doesn't happen, of course, if for any reason the Chinese find that they can't make it happen, then that will put a lot of pressure on gas markets globally. And United States, we're very confident about this. Russia, very big reserves, we're confident. Of course, most of that will happen after 2020. Australia, my own country here, will become a very big exporter. And again, we're very confident about that. Most of that is happening already. Qatar already a big exporter. So, that's the general gas picture. Let's talk a little bit about unconventional gas and where we see it going. These reserve numbers, this is from last year's World Energy Outlook. You can see China, a very big reserve holder in shale, but also in coal bed methane and tight gas. Australia as well, North America, Europe as well. Yeah, we'll talk, if I get time, we can talk a little bit about Europe. This is a widely distributed resource, but the technology for the moment remains in North America. I've talked a lot about the US, but Canada as well is a big, potentially big gas producer, but one that cannot get its gas to market because, of course, its major market is the United States. So, growth in gas, unconventional gas. We've got shale here and coal bed methane. I do want to talk a little bit about coal bed methane if I get the chance. Clearly, this has been, to date, a US and Canadian phenomenon, with Australia coming right in behind it with the coal bed methane. Over the forecast period, we see China becoming very important as well. Argentina, a policy limited market, plenty of gas, plenty of shale. Can they get together? You guys may know that better than me. In coal bed methane, again, Australia and China will be very big producers. China, the big uncertainty here, the big wild card. Some of these numbers we're much more certain about than others. Much, much more certain. Just again for scale here, remember Spain is about 30 billion cubic metres, give or take a bit. Used to be 35, we'll say 30 now, just back in here. So these are big numbers globally. This is a US forecast. Well, it was made in 2011, just to show that even the experts, and this is actually made by the American administration, back in 2005, this goes back to 1990, 2005, we had a peak here, and of course the conventional wisdom that this was just going to decline in a very genteel way, requiring the US to import a lot of gas. Now, even in 2011, you can see the shale expansion here in tight gas, but particularly shale, and projected to keep increasing. Again, these numbers here are, Spain is 3 on this scale. So you can see US dry natural gas, quite dramatic. What in fact has happened has been even more dramatic forecasts. And this is dry shale gas, and as I said, Spain is down here at 3. One region I want to look at is this green wedge here. This is the Marcellus Formation, and this is Pennsylvania, basically. And in 2008, production in this area was effectively zero. And by late 2013, when I downloaded this graph, it was approximately 120 billion cubic metres. So roughly 4 times Spanish gas use, and that's happened in 5 years. Now, lots of people said, well, these wells deplete very rapidly, this is going to decline, this is not going to keep happening. So I downloaded the graph last night, or yesterday afternoon, and you can, this is Marcellus, and since that graph was taken, this has now gone up to nearly 160 billion cubic metres up here. Now, this is as of July, this is increasing by roughly 2 billion cubic metres per month, production per month. So 160 billion cubic metres here is again roughly 5 times Spanish gas use. And I guess another astonishing thing here is well productivity. People say, well, these wells deplete, you know, and they do deplete rapidly, but look what's happening to the productivity here. In 2009, every well was producing, you know, 1 million cubic feet a day. Now they produce 6 to 7 million cubic feet a day. And that's in, 3 or 4 years. Now, I can talk a lot about what's driving that productivity, but I can certainly tell you they use a lot less water, they use a lot less drilling effort, they're getting a lot smarter at what they do. And these are dramatic changes, and this is why we think the US can continue to produce gas for the $4, $5, perhaps $6 maximum. So just to give you a little bit of interesting, people quote the Henry Hub all the time. This is the map of the US. Henry Hub down here last year, $3.73 per million BTU average price. As I said, that's around about $20 to $25 oil. But up here in Pennsylvania, where this Marcellus is, up here, price is, guess what, $3.17, even cheaper. Interestingly enough, the state right next door, New York, does not allow hydraulic fracking. It's forbidden. Does sound familiar? France, Germany. What happens, of course, in New York, if you look right here, you can see, if those of you who know your American geography, you can see here the price in New York is $5 per million BTU, right next door. $3, $5. 60% more expensive. You can make your choices. Okay, there's a few issues here. There's about gas transport and a whole collection of things, but it's clear that this area here is producing a lot of gas, but this area is not. Just to have a closer look at this, this is Pennsylvania, this little square box here in the middle, and the eastern half of Pennsylvania here also does not allow hydraulic fracking. That's in the basin of the Susquehanna River and the Delaware River, if you know your American geography. So all the gas is produced here in this western part, and it's quite a small area. I mean, it's quite a bit smaller than Spain, a lot smaller than Spain. We're talking sort of Catalonia type size here. And the fourth LNG project, the US has now approved three. It approved its fourth LNG project. Its fourth LNG project will export gas from that area down here at the end of Maryland. Again, that's Washington, D.C. just there. And that gas will come straight across there. That's about a 20 billion cubic meter LNG export project. So there are four of those. The US, when all those four projects start up, will be exporting a minimum of 80 billion cubic meters, which will make it the number three LNG exporter globally. Another country, just to talk quickly about, China. Big country, China. These red, I won't bother to translate the Chinese for you, but these red areas are very high quality shale gas resources. Blue areas, moderately good quality. And that province here is Sichuan province, capital Chengdu. A very promising gas production area. Very, very important globally. You might think, well, I mean, sitting here in Spain or in Europe, what happens in China matters globally. I can't let a moment go by without talking about Australia. This area, this little box here, is roughly the size of Spain. So Australia's a big, big country. And you can see these gas gathering pipelines here, these red dots, are coal-bed methane areas, and they'll be exported through this port here of Gladstone. And the first gas will likely come out of Gladstone next month or the month after. And there'll be three and possibly four projects exporting gas. So when these projects come on stream, plus the others being built in Australia, Australia will be bigger than Qatar exporting LNG. Most of that gas, of course, will go to Asia. And indeed, just again quickly, where do we see? This is LNG supply. And by 2019, here's Australia. Here's the US, way too small. The US will have to revise this year. That will be quite a bit bigger, although some of the projects, this is 2019, some of those projects will still be coming on stream. Qatar, still very important here in the middle. What does all this mean in terms of the US? US exports, I'm assuming here a $4 price, or it might be a little bit higher than that. If you add in liquefaction, shipping and regasification, it means that US gas can be delivered into Asia for $10 at a time when the price is more than $15. And for Europe, less than $9 delivered at a time when prices are in the $10, $12 range. So potentially, US gas may be cheaper, or somebody may make a lot of money. I'm not quite sure which, but it's clear that that US gas, which will mostly go to Asia, and again here, I'm looking at the markets here, OECD Asia, which is Japan, Korea, and non-OECD Asia and China, make up the vast bulk of LNG market change. So you've been a very good audience listening to my terrible Australian accent. I just want to conclude on the issue of regulation, and this is a very important subject. The IEA has spent a lot of time looking at the issue of regulation. We have a saying in Australia, my football team's playing catch-up football. What this means is my side is down 2-0 and I'm having to chase goals because I need to equalise the score. That's where regulators have been globally. This is an industry that has very rapidly kicked goals. The industry is ahead 2-0. Governments and regulators everywhere are struggling to catch up. This is an industry that needs very strong regulation. Of that there is no doubt. We put out a publication in 2012 called The Golden Rules. I won't go through them all here. That will take too long. But regulators need to be involved in this industry. Some countries, and France is one of them, have chosen to take the approach of outright prohibition. That is a way to ensure that, one, you won't have any unconventional gas production, and two, you will have higher gas prices. Fine. That's a choice countries can make. But if they choose to go down the route of unconventional gas exploitation, then regulators need to be involved. I won't run through these rules. We can talk about them if you like. But some of the recent experience, number four, most regulatory concerns are about water. And it's raining outside, I know, but I think Spain, water concerns are important, and certainly in Australia, water concerns are very, very important. We are a very dry country. Everywhere we go, water is an issue, and a lot of regulatory concerns come around number four, which leads back to number one, because one of the things that regulators need to ensure that before drilling goes in, people have good baseline data. They need to understand where the water is, what the water quality is, so that if and when it's affected, people can take appropriate action. And on number six, we need to assess the impacts on a cumulative and area-wide basis. We can't just do this on a project-by-project, well-by-well basis. So that's sort of setting the scene for later discussions, but this is a very important part of what this industry is about. So I'll conclude with some final observations. This is the IEA runs a series of forums. Our first unconventional gas forum was in Paris in 2013. Our most recent one was in March in Calgary this year. I don't know whether any of you went to that. Calgary was cool, about minus 10 in fact, but a very interesting forum and one that we learnt a lot about increasing productivity. Our next forum, which will be in March next year, will be in Chengdu, which is the capital of Sichuan province in China, underlining the importance of China. Some concluding thoughts. I'm going to run through these slides quite quickly because I'm looking at my watch telling me the time is ticking away. But I just want to talk a little bit about prices. If we go back to 2003, just a decade or so ago, Europe, this is the ratio of industrial energy prices relative to the US. So Japan was nearly double, but the European Union was roughly the same as the United States. Wasn't much in it. China was a little bit cheaper. If we move ahead to 2013, we see that Japan is now five times nearly, Europe is now three times. Now, if you're in the business of making fertilizer or ammonia or anything that uses gas, it means you're not going to do business in either European Union or probably not China, certainly not Japan, and you're probably going to go to the US Gulf Coast, and that's exactly what's happening. Similarly, in terms of the forecast period, we did not see those prices changing. They will lower, but Japan and the EU will remain uncompetitive in gas. For electricity, we see much the same story. 2003, we've seen those differentials increase, and guess what? They'll stay the same. What that means for global export markets for energy-intensive goods, and that covers a whole range of goods, which I can go into. But over the forecast period, we can see those countries going up. US, it's a big economy, so it doesn't show up that much. But for the EU and Japan, big negative impacts. Quite important. So just to quickly summarise, hopefully you've got the message that China is driving the growing dominance of Asia in energy and gas markets. What happens in China matters everywhere, in every single market, oil, gas, coal. Haven't talked about oil and coal, happy to do so. Fabulous new technology is opening up large new gas resources very quickly, first in North America, both Canada and the United States, and then Australia, possibly China. But where else and when, and how will regulators work with the industry? Regulation is a key part of this industry. There's a lot of lessons that can be learned from what's happened. The United States has got some good examples and plenty of bad examples, as does Australia. I can definitely speak on that. And finally, these regional price gaps and concerns over competitiveness are here to stay. They've grown very large in the last 10 years, and they'll be with us for a long time. So with those remarks, I conclude. You've been very good to put up with my Australian accent as long as that, but I'm happy to answer questions, and I'll be around for the rest of the seminar.
Thank you very much, Ian, for this extremely interesting presentation. And as you said, I think that there is time at least for a couple of questions from the audience. So whoever wants to raise the hand, and is there any question? So if there are no questions, at least I will try to and it's not that I want to be provocative, but nothing against regulation. There is plenty of people around that has been trying to regulate us for years and so on. But don't you think that situation in states, and of course there are other reasons, but situations in states is different than in Europe, and particularly certain countries in Europe, because there is, I don't know if probably you could say better, but at least less regulation. We are over-regulated here.
Okay, there are many aspects of the United States and Canada that are obviously different to Europe. I guess the first and probably the most important thing is in the United States, the underground mineral rights are vested with the owner of the land, the surface land. And that's quite unusual amongst IEA countries. And it means that if you are the owner of that land, you have a very big incentive to allow drilling on your land. You get a check every month, month in, month out, a very large check in some cases, and that makes people very keen to allow drilling, which is obviously not the case in Europe, or indeed Canada, interestingly enough. So Canada is a bit more interesting. So I guess that's the first difference. The second difference is, of course, that Europe is much more densely populated. Water resources are much, the whole environmental issue in Europe, and again, I'll talk for France because it's where I live most of the time. France is certainly very aware of water issues. A lot of rivers are much drier than they used to be, just to pick one example, and that's true in other countries in Europe as well. And secondly, of course, thirdly, of course, the technology of the shale in Europe is proving more difficult. Some Hungarian colleagues went about drilling and found that the type of shale, the rock properties, the brittleness of the shale, to give one example, its porosity, permeability, for those of you who are geologists in the audience, found to be much more difficult, much more expensive. Now, having said that, of course, that graph I showed could show over time how productivity can improve. So people say, well, it won't be as productive, it won't be as cheap in Europe. You need to start and you need to get up that learning curve. But you are correct, it'll be much more difficult in Europe. Europe is a much more regulated place than the United States or Canada. Australia is a different category, I think. Again, more like Europe in the sense that obviously we don't have the population density, but we have a very concerned level of citizens and a very high concern over water issues. So yes, this will be tough.
In one of the slides, you have mentioned a reduction of gas consumption in European Union. Which part of this reduction has gone to coal? I mean, we have reduced gas, but I'm afraid we have replaced a significant part of this consumption by the more polluting coal.
Okay, that's a really good question again. And of course, one of the offshoots, one of the interesting thing that's happened in the United States is because gas prices are now at $3 and $4, coal, which in most coal prices vary in the United States, but in the eastern part of the United States, coal is around about $70 to $75 a tonne, which is around $3 per million BTU. So gas and coal are very competitive in some parts of the US, and indeed gas has pushed coal out of the power sector. It wasn't that long ago, coal was 50% of US power, now it's 35%. So that coal has had to find a home, and some of that coal, a lot of that coal has found its way into the Atlantic Basin. Colombian coal, which used to be imported in the US, again has found its way to Europe. So the import of that has been that coal prices have become cheap again, quite a bit cheaper than we've seen historically, and we've seen coal consumption increase in Germany, Netherlands, I don't know about Spain, but certainly the United Kingdom as well. So yes, the electricity sector in particular has seen a big increase in coal use. German emissions have gone up, much to the consternation of the Germans. The Germans do pride themselves on a very active greenhouse policy, very strong encouragement of renewables, but it's not having results at the moment. As long as coal stays cheap and gas is expensive, and of course gas is expensive in Europe, and incremental gas is of course oil-indexed gas, more or less, which is at least $12. And I guess worse than that, of course, incremental gas is now Russian gas, and we have a very big question mark against Russian gas going over the winter. You're probably aware that gas supplies from Russia to Ukraine have stopped now for some months, and I think we're all a little bit worried over the winter. We saw interruptions in 2006 and 2009. They did not affect Spain, obviously. Spain is a little bit islanded from the rest of Europe in that regard. But, yeah, there's some very important issues about Russian gas. So, yeah, what's happened in the US has had immediate impacts on coal markets globally and certainly in Europe.
Pedro, two short questions. Just one. One is very short. One is regarding the fracking technology. What is your opinion regarding using other liquids than water, like LPGs or similar? And the second question is regarding the production of unconventional gas, shale gas, which most of this gas is wet gas, and that means there is a lot of condensates coming in. And what will be the effect on the petrochemical business, either in the United States and in Europe?
There's really good questions. And I guess the first thing to talk about is if you've seen the more recent fracking operations in British Columbia, just to pick one example, the drillers now build themselves a pad, a concrete area roughly the size of a football field, and they set up the drill in one corner, and they drill horizontally out about between 3 and 5 kilometres, and then they frack right at the very end, they extract the water, they drill some between 20 and 30 wells from that one pad. In the middle of the pad is a water treatment facility. They extract, they use, the water goes in for fracking, it's produced, extracted, treated, and goes back into the next well. So immediately the amount of water that's being used is way, way less than before. Dramatic improvements in productivity. I didn't show the water use, but it looks the same as that chart for productivity, except in the opposite direction. So water use is dropping dramatically. The amount of chemical use is dropping because it saves money. Very strong imperative when gas prices are only $3 to reduce chemical use. So the direction of the technology is still to use water, but to reduce water use, to recycle, to use municipal wastewater. The area, the community where this was, where these operations are going on, did not have a municipal wastewater facility, treatment facility. They just dumped it in the river. That's now treated by the companies, and that's the water they use. So, of course, the Chinese, who also have similar water issues, again, very interested in this technology. The second part of that question is about liquids. Not all shale or unconventional gas is wet. Some of it is. And part of the economics of doing this is you look for the wet gas because you get gas and oil. Coal bed methane in Australia and in most places is dry, sad for the economics. Shale in some countries will be wet, will be dry, and everything in between. The industry is getting very good at drilling those, detecting them and finding them. And of course those liquids are a very important part of what I put up there. But that resource, the wet pockets will run out before the gas runs out in the US. And in fact, when our projections come out, you will see that production in the US of that light oil peaks and then drops over the projection over the next 20 years. So that peak is actually relatively soon, around 2030, you'll see it and then start to drop. Gas keeps going up. So good questions, great questions.
Thank you very much, Ian. So this comes to the end of this session. Bueno, acabamos aquí pues esta parte introductoria con esta interesantísima presentación y discusión, y damos paso ya a la siguiente sesión.